Hi everyone, welcome to our channel Pinku for You. I am less as a teacher, more as a storyteller. In our previous class, we have discussed about emergence of Islam and then Delhi Sultanates. Now in this session, we will discuss about Mughals. Already in our previous class, we have discussed the background of Mughals. If you missed that class, also no problem. Now I will start from the beginning of Mughals. The founder of Mughal Empire was Babur. Babur is the founder of the Mughal Empire. And Babur's actual name is Jahiruddin Muhammad. He ruled from 1526 to 1530. Founder of Mughals was Babur. And his actual name is Jahiruddin Muhammad. Now we will see how he established this Mughal Empire. Actually, Babur is connected to Mongols. He is a Mongolian. During Delhi Sultanate time, we have seen so many Mongol invasions happened in India. Babur is connected to these Mongols and he is related to Timur's family. Actually, Babur is the grandson of Timur. Timur is the famous Mongolian leader. During the Genghis Khan period, Mongolians started plundering this world. After his death, Mongolians divided into so many subgroups. Later, they stopped plundering activities. After some period, Timur came forward and united all these Mongolian groups and again started doing plundering activities. Timur's grandson is Babur from father's side. And mother's side is Genghis Khan. Genghis Khan from mother's side. Babur is already a ruler in Fergana. Fergana is a place which is above Afghanistan. Already he is a ruler in Fergana at 1494 Anno Domini. Now we will see story what actually happened. There was a tribe known as Uzbeks. Let me open another page. No, present day Uzbekistan is there, that one only. There was a tribe named Uzbeks. Current day Uzbekistan people. Just assume like that. These were Sunni Muslims. These Uzbeks were Sunni Muslims. This tribe said that there is one kingdom which is established by Shia Muslims. Till now, we have seen only Sunni Muslim kingdoms. Delhi Sultanates, all are Sunni Muslims only. But there was a one kingdom which is known as Safavid dynasty. These were Shia Muslims. In our previous class, we have discussed about Sunni Muslims and Shia Muslims. Like in Hinduism, we have Shaivas and Vaishnavas. Similarly, in Islam, we are having Sunni Muslim and Shia Muslim. But there was only one God, Allah, for Islam. Whereas in Hinduism, we have multiple gods. However, they have only one God, but there was two groups, that is Sunni Muslim and Shia Muslim. Sunni Muslim was started by Abu Bakr and Shia Muslim was started by Ali. So these Uzbeks were Sunni Muslim tribes. These Uzbeks wanted to protect this Sunni Muslim as well as to extend this Sunni Muslim. So they wanted to attack this Safavid dynasty. These Uzbeks wanted to attack the Safavid dynasty. For this, they want to support from Ottoman Turks. These were another dynasty people. They wanted this Ottoman Turks to support this Uzbeks as well as Babur from Fergana region. These Ottoman Turks supported this Uzbeks, but Babur did not want to give support to Uzbeks. So these Uzbeks wanted to take revenge on this Babur. So they occupied Babur's uncle territory, that is Samarkand. Firstly, they occupied Babur's uncle territory, Samarkand. During this time, Babur escaped and ran away from Fergana. He is the ruler of Fergana. So Babur escaped and ran away from Fergana. And then Babur went to Safavid dynasty and told what actually happened is. So Babur finally gained support from this Safavid dynasty, and Babur attacked this Uzbeks and occupied Samarkand and also his own place, that is Fergana. Finally Babur occupied Samarkand and Fergana. Now this Safavid dynasty people asked to implement their rules in this Samarkand and Fergana, that is suzerainty. Suzerainty means implementing another party rules. Just like another policies we are implementing in our state, that is suzerainty. This Safavid dynasty people asked Babur to implement their policies in Fergana and Samarkand. Babur did not accept this. Now this Safavid dynasty people wanted to revolt against Babur. But this time Babur ran away from this Fergana. However, there was no supporters for Babur. In west side, there were Ottoman Turks, Uzbeks, Safavid dynasty. All these people wanted to revolt against Babur. So Babur thought that it's not fair to revolt against this western side part. So he wanted to establish his kingdom in eastern side. While he was looking for the territory to occupy in eastern side, at that time only Babur got an offer from Daulat Khan. In our previous session, we had discussed about this. Just all what happened, you people know. I explained in previous class. No worries. Now I will explain in brief. Ibrahim Lodi is ruling in Delhi region. He has a habit to humiliate people in front of everyone in his court. This Ibrahim Lodi criticized this Daulat Khan in front of everyone. So Daulat Khan wanted to take revenge on Ibrahim Lodi. At that time, Daulat Khan searching for a Mongolian. Mongolian are very much interested in plundering activities, not to occupy territory. By this intention, Daulat Khan wanted a Mongolian. At this time only, he found Babur. What actually Daulat Khan thought is, Babur is a Mongolian, so he is not interested to occupy territory, he is just interested in plundering activity. That is why Daulat Khan approached this Babur. But Babur's actual intention is to establish his kingdom in eastern side. So Babur accepted his proposal, and then Babur attacked Delhi. First battle of Panipat. Panipat is a place near to Delhi, and this happened in 1526 AD. This was a battle between Babur and Ibrahim Lodi. Finally, Babur defeated this Ibrahim Lodi. Now Babur wanted to occupy this Delhi's throne. Daulat Khan don't want to see Babur as a ruler. So Daulat Khan fought against with Babur. Babur defeated this Daulat Khan also. And finally Babur became Delhi's ruler. And then Mughal dynasty established. This is how Mughal empire formed. Now we will see Babur's ruling period. Babur ruled from 1526 to 1530. In this period, he fought totally 4 wars. That is, let me open another page. Babur fought 4 battles. First one is Battle of Panipat. Just now we discussed about this battle. It happened in 1526 AD. Second is Battle of Kanwa. It happened in 1527. Third is Battle of Chanderi, 1528. Finally, Battle of Gagra in 1529. These were the places. In all these battles, Babur won. He extended this Mughal empire. Babur is not contributed any art and architecture. Babur is a great scholar. He used to write in Arabic and Persian language. His mother tongue is Turkey. He wrote a book in his mother tongue. His mother tongue is Turkey and he wrote a book. That book name is Tujuk-i-Babri in Turkish language. He wrote this book. This book deals about his own biography. And then he always tries to expand his territory so that only he is not contributed much in art and architecture. In 1530, Babur died. He got natural death and Babur died at 1530 at Agra. And his tomb is in Kabul, present day Kabul. Mughals did not give much importance to ministers. In Delhi Sultanates, they have given much importance, like Chahalgani, 40 noble ministers, which was started by Iltutmish. Whereas Mughals did not give much importance to ministers. And they protected Islam also, but also supported other religions. Delhi Sultanates only protected Islam, but they did not give much importance to other religion. Whereas Mughals protected Islam as well as they supported other religions. Mughals followed Taimur's administration. According to it, if the king had multiple sons, then he need to divide his kingdom equally. So that after Babur dead, Babur's 4 sons took the empire equally. These 4 sons were Humayun, he is the eldest son of Babur, Kamran, Askari, Hindal. These were 4 sons of Babur. Humayun is eldest and Hindal is the youngest son of Babur. This capital of Delhi was took by Humayun. Present day Pak and Kabul was took by Kamran. Agra region by Hindal. Gujarat region by Askari. If any kingdom wanted to defeat any of these 4 kingdoms, means these remaining brothers has to support another brother's kingdom. This is the policy. These brothers didn't give support to Humayun. Firstly, an Afghan leader known as Sher Shah Suri. This Sher Shah Suri wanted to take the throne of Delhi because Ibrahim Lodi is Afghan leader. After his death, Mughals established this Mughal dynasty. So Sher Shah Suri is an Afghan leader who wanted to see Afghans again in Delhi's throne. So Sher Shah Suri attacked this Delhi. At that time, Delhi was ruling by Humayun. According to policy, remaining three brothers has to support Humayun, but they never supported this Humayun. And then this Sher Shah defeated Humayun. This battle is known as Battle of Chausa, which happened in 1539 Anno Domini. No brothers helped Humayun, and finally Sher Shah Suri destroyed Humayun's Mughal army, and Humayun ran away from Delhi. Again, Humayun wanted to battle with Sher Shah Suri. After an year, Humayun again started revolting against Sher Shah Suri. This battle is known as Battle of Bilgan. In this Battle of Bilgram, again Sher Shah Suri defeated this Humayun. This happened in 1540. Finally, Sher Shah Suri completely won battles against Humayun, and then he occupied Delhi's throne. Humayun ran away from this Delhi region, and Humayun left to Sindh region for next 15 years. Humayun ran and left to Sindh region as a refugee. Now Sher Shah Suri established his own dynasty, that is Suri dynasty. Now we will see Sher Shah's administration and how he is. Sher Shah Suri. This dynasty ruled from 1540 to 1555 Anno Domini, Suri dynasty. Sher Shah Suri established this Suri dynasty. It ruled from 1540 to 1555. Totally it ruled 15 years. Sher Shah Suri, he got the title as Sher Shah because he killed a tiger with his hands, not using any weapons. He killed with his own hands, so that only he got title Sher Shah. His name is Suri, so he established this Suri dynasty. Now we will see battles of Sher Shah Suri. First battle is Malwa campaign. Sher Shah Suri, very much powerful leader and also cruel leader. In this Malwa campaign, he killed so many Rajput rulers. Sher Shah attacked Rajput rulers. Rajput rulers gathered with other Rajput rulers along with their families at Chanderi Fort. At Chanderi Fort, all these Rajput rulers gathered just to attack this Sher Shah Suri. Sher Shah Suri promised these Rajput rulers, if they came out of this Chanderi Fort, then he will not attack this Rajput rulers. For this oath, all these Rajput rulers opened the gates of Chanderi Fort. Now Sher Shah Suri attacked Rajput rulers and their families, and they killed everyone. This is what Malwa campaign. He broke this oath. Now we will see Rajasthan campaign. King Maldio of Mewar. He is one of the powerful ruler from Rajput family. King Maldio of Mewar is defeating other Rajput rulers as well. So local rulers and relatives of Maldio asked Sher Shah for help. And Sher Shah also shown keen interest, as it may be a threat to Delhi as well. When the war started between Sher Shah and Maldiyo, these Rajput rulers and relatives of Maldiyo supported Maldiyo only, and they attacked Sher Shah in reverse. Now Sher Shah continuously keep on attacking. Finally, Sher Shah killed Maldiyo and many Rajput rulers. In this campaign, during the end of this war, at a place called Kalinjar. In this Kalinjar, this Sher Shah got severely injured and Sher Shah died. At 1550 AD, Sher Shah died. After Sher Shah, next successor is Islam Shah. He ruled from 1552 to 1553. Islam Shah. He died at young age. After Islam Shah, there was a lot of disturbance among them about their next successor. Taking this as an opportunity, Humayun started revolting on Delhi. And then Humayun re-established this Mughal Empire. Because there was no proper rulers in Surat dynasty. Finally, Humayun back to Delhi's throne. Now we will see Sher Shah's administration. Diwan-e-Wazir. This term refers to revenue finance. Diwan-e-Arz, army in charge. Diwan-e-Rasalat, foreign minister. Diwan-e-Insha, Minister of Communication. These were some of the posts during Sher Shah's administration. Now we will discuss about Humayun. Humayun married to Hamida Begum at Sindh region. When he was in Sindh, at the time he married Hamida Begum. He took shelter at a king named Rana Prasad. He gave shelter to Humayun in 1540. He gave shelter to Humayun. During this time, Humayun married Hamida Begum. Hamida Banu Begum. Akbar born at 1542 AD. Akbar born at 1542 AD. Humayun wants to re-establish his Mughal Empire in Delhi. Actually, the name Humayun means fortune in Islamic world. However, this Humayun is unfortunate ruler, because after he established his kingdom, Sher Shah Suri attacked this Humayun. After re-established his kingdom, within a span of 1 year, this Humayun died accidentally. In 1556, Humayun died while he is constructing a library. He fell down from steps. Humayun died accidentally. After his death, Humayun's wife beautifully constructed a tomb for her husband surrounded by gardens in Delhi. This is what about Humayun. Now we will see Akbar. Humayun's son is Akbar. Akbar born at 1542. As the Akbar is a small kid, at the time of his father's death, Bairam Khan, who is the minister under Humayun, Bairam Khan participated in wars on the behalf of Akbar. It is the second battle of Panipat. First battle of Panipat is in between Babur and Ibrahim Lodi. This second battle of Panipat is between Hemu, a king named Hemu, possessed Akbar. It happened in 1556 AD on November 5th. In this battle, Akbar did not participate directly because he is a small kid. So, on behalf of him, Bairam Khan participated. Hemu is a small dynasty ruler. After knowing this, there was no proper ruler in Delhi, so Hemu wanted to take throne of Delhi. Second battle of Panipat happened between Hemu and Bairam Khan, that is Akbar. Finally, Bairam Khan defeated this Hemu. Bairam Khan defeated this Hemu, but it came to Akbar's account. Akbar crowned at 1556. At the age of 14 only, Akbar got crowned. But Bairam Khan ruling this empire on the behalf of Akbar. Now we will discuss more about Akbar. Akbar's ruling period is from 1556 to 1605. Akbar born at 1542 and he got crowned at 1556. He born at 1542 at a place called Amarkot. From 1556 to 1562, Bairam Khan is ruling on behalf of Akbar. This is called Pardak administration. This is known as Pardak administration. From 1562, Akbar directly took administration. Now Akbar became complete ruler. Akbar fought with many kingdoms. Like Akbar fought with Malwa, Gondwana, Bengal, Gujarat, Kashmir, Odisha. He fought with so many kingdoms. Akbar directly did not fight with these kingdoms. Akbar sent Raja Man Singh. He is a famous ruler. In later period, Raja Man Singh became friend to Akbar. So Akbar sent Raja Man Singh for all these battles and Raja Man Singh won these battles. Akbar is a good administrator. Akbar's tutor Bairam Khan is a Shia Muslim. Bairam Khan's son Abdul Rahim Khan is converted into Hindu Vaishnavism. Akbar's teacher Abdul Latif is Sufi. He is a Sufi Muslim. Akbar exposed to various religions. So Akbar gave respect to all religions. He did not show caste discrimination. He gave importance to each and every religion. What actually Akbar did is, after defeating other rulers, he did not kill them. He is just maintaining friendly relationships with other rulers. Akbar also constructed Ibadat Khana. Ibadat Khana. This is a place where all religion discussions takes place. He constructed at Fatehpur Sikri. It is a place. All religion officials will discuss about implementing other religion policies and ideas, everything. This is what Ibadat Khana. This is a meeting. He constructed this hall at Fatehpur Sikri. Akbar also maintained Khutba, a prayer for Muslims. It is a prayer for Muslims in Moti Masjid. Moti Masjid at Fatehpur Sikri. There is a text wrote during the time of Akbar. This text is known as Ain-i-Akbari. This is about Akbar. This is wrote by Abul Fazl. He is one of the Navaratna in Akbar's court. Abul Fazl wrote Ain-e-Akbari. This is about Akbar's administration, everything. And also Akbar maintained his own religion. He introduced a religion called Tawhid-e-Ilahi. Tawhid-e-Ilahi. This was a religion which was founded by Akbar. Every religion people can accept this religion if they want to convert into this Tawhid-e-Ilahi. It opened to every religion. But during those days, people did not accept this new religion. Only very few members followed this Tawhid-e-Ilahi. One among them is Birbal. Birbal is a Rajput ruler. His actual name is Mahesh Das. He is a powerful leader. He is very intelligent and smart. Later he became close friend to Akbar. Akbar's policy is to maintain close relationship to other rulers also. So he became a good friend to Akbar. Later Birbal followed this Tawhid-e-Ilahi religion. Akbar just suggested this religion as alternative for other religions, but did not force any people to join this religion compulsory. However, people at that time did not accept this religion. Akbar introduced Mansabdari system. Mansab means rank. Mansabdari means rank holder. Mansab means rank. Mansabdari means rank holder. Depending upon number of cavalrymen you maintain, you can be awarded a rank. Now we will see Mansabdari system. Mansab means rank. Mansab. $7,000 to $5,000 means you can call it as Amir E. Umda. 5,000 to 2,500, you call it as Amir. From 2,500 to 500, Mansabdar. From 500 to 10, also Mansabdar. Category. First rank from 7,000 to 5,000. Second rank from 5,000 to 2,500. Third rank from 2,500 to 500. This is what about category. Mansabdar was paid by Jagirs, that means tax collectors. For each Mansabdar, 30,000 per month. But those days, 30,000 per month means it's a high amount. It's a very huge amount. Depending upon the maintenance of cavalry, you will be awarded a rank. Lowest rank is 10, highest rank is 7,000. Mansabdar's duty is to get salary, that means they need to collect tax from Jagirs. If the Jagir tax is 50,000, then Mansabdar gets 30,000 and 20,000 to king. This is what Mansabdar. These were not paid by cash. They were given Jagir to collect cash. From this, they get salary. Birbal is Rajput ruler and very close to Akbar. Maan Singh is participating in wars on behalf of Akbar. After the death of Akbar, this Mansabdar is not maintained properly by the next successors of Akbar. Mughals followed Taimur's tradition. However, Akbar did not follow Taimur's tradition. Akbar made a lot of changes in this administration. We will discuss more about Akbar. Akbar abolished jizya tax. This tax is for non-Muslims. What this tax is? This tax is for non-Muslims for getting protection from a Muslim ruler. This tax was abolished by Akbar. And also pilgrim tax. Both taxes were abolished by Akbar because Akbar gave respect to each and every religion. By having special relationship with Rajput rulers, he strengthened his army. In 1575, Akbar built a hall called Ibadat Khana at Fatehpur Sikri. This is for all religious head meeting. Akbar used to interact with them. However, Qazis did not like Akbar's policies, like Brahmin priests in Hinduism, Qazis in Muslim. So these Qazis are against to Akbar. Akbar is famous for Navaratna. Navaratna means it's not oil. It's actually 9 important personalities. That means one is famous in astrology, one is famous in poetry. Like that, there were 9 people in Akbar's court. Akbar used to call them as Navaratnas. Married Jodha. She is the daughter of Raja Birmal, a Rajput ruler. Akbar married Jodha. This shows how Akbar gives respect to Hinduism. Finally, Akbar died at 27th October 1605. He got natural death. He died at Agra. No one killed Akbar. He got natural death only at 1605 in Agra. Next, we will see Akbar's next successor. After Akbar, his son Jahangir ruled. Jahangir ruled from 1605 to 1627. Jahangir's wife Noor Jahan. She assisted Jahangir for all decision-making activities. Actual name for Jahangir is Salim. Jahangir is a title which is given by Akbar. Noor Jahan's actual name is Mehrunnisa. Mehrunnisa's second husband is Jahangir. She is the most powerful woman in Mughal era. Even she maintained a separate group in Jahangir's court. Shah Jahan is one among them in that group. Jahangir met Mehrunnisa in Meena Bazaar and decided to marry her, though she already married. Jahangir had war with Mehrunnisa's husband, and then finally Jahangir married Mehrunnisa, and Jahangir given her title as Noor Jahan. Noor Jahan plays an important role in all decision making activities of Jahangir. Mehrunnisa's first husband was also a ruler near Bengal region. Jahangir fought with Noor Jahan's husband and then he married Noor Jahan. Jahangir has more than 8 wives. Shah Jahan's stepmother is Noor Jahan. Shah Jahan's actual name is Khurram. Khurram is the actual name of Shah Jahan. Shah Jahan is a title which is given by his father Jahangir. In later period, this Khurram started revolting against this Noor Jahan. After Jahangir, Shah Jahan became leader by revolting against Noor Jahan. Noor Jahan introduced silver coins. Rather than Jahangir, Noor Jahan played an important role in administration. So Noor Jahan introduced silver coins on her name with the title Badshah Begum. She issued silver coins with the name of Badshah Begum. She developed in Persian art and culture, contributed in the improvement of women's condition. Jahangir wrote his own biography, which is known as Tujik-e-Jahangir. in Persian language he wrote. When Jahangir is alive, he built his own tomb in Lahore. When he is alive only, he built his tomb. And then Jahangir died in Kashmir. This is what about Jahangir. Rather than Jahangir, Nur Jahan only played an important role in all decision-making activities and everything. Jahangir is just like an puppet ruler, means Tolubamma in Telugu. He is just like puppet ruler. However, Nur Jahan contributed a lot rather than Jahangir. Now we will discuss about Shah Jahan. Shah Jahan's ruling period is from 1628 to 1657. We all know how Shah Jahan came into power. He revolted against Nur Jahan and occupied Delhi's throne. His birth name is Khurram. Khurram is the birth name. Khurram means happiness. Shah Jahan's mother is Jagat Gosai. Other name is Jodhabai. She is a daughter of Hindu Rajput ruler. Shah Jahan had many battles with other rulers. He did not maintain friendly relationship like Akbar. When we come to know about Jahangir, he did not play an important role in maintaining friendly relationships, as well as he did not take part in wars. Akbar maintained a friendly relationship with other rulers, but Shah Jahan did not maintain it. He had many wars with other rulers. It is the Battle of Hubli in 1632. There he defeated Portuguese era in India. He defeated this Portuguese era in India at the Battle of Hubli in 1632. After this battle, there was no domination of Portuguese. This is how Shah Jahan stopped Portuguese administration in India. Shah Jahan's period is known as golden era of Indian art and architecture. He constructed many monuments. Famous were Taj Mahal. He constructed Taj Mahal, Jamma Masjid, Red Fort, Peacock Throne. Shah Jahan's throne also had Kohinoor and Dariya-e-Noor. That means diamond. Shah Jahan's beloved wife Mumtaz died very soon after their marriage. So, for the memory of love, he constructed this Taj Mahal. To perpetuate her memory, he built Taj Mahal at Agra in 1632. Finally, it completed at 1653. Finally, the construction of Taj Mahal got completed at 1653. Shah Jahan had 4 sons. Dara Shikoh is the eldest son. Shuja is the second son. Aurangzeb is very important ruler. He is the third son of Shah Jahan. And Murad Bakhsh is the fourth son of Shah Jahan. According to Timur's policy, when the king is about to death, he need to divide his kingdom among his sons equally. So Shah Jahan divided equally Delhi's throne to Dara Shikoh, Shuja to Bengal region, Aurangzeb Deccan region, Murad Bakhshi Gujarat and Malwa region. This is how Shah Jahan divided kingdom equally to his sons. Aurangzeb want complete these kingdoms under his control. Dharashikoh is a powerful ruler. So what Aurangzeb did is, he asked his brother Murad to help him for killing his brother Dharashikoh, and said that after the death of Dharashikoh, we will share equally. He brainwashed this Murad. So Murad supported Aurangzeb. Aurangzeb killed Dharashikoh at Battle of Dharmath. In this battle, Aurangzeb killed Dharashikoh. Dharashikoh is just like second Akbar. He is a very good person, whereas Aurangzeb is very cruel. And Dharashikoh is a very powerful leader. So with the help of Murad Baksh, Aurangzeb killed Dharashikoh. After killing Dharashikoh, with the head of Dharashikoh, he passed throughout Delhi street. After this, Aurangzeb killed Murad also. This battle is known as Battle of Durai. In this battle, he killed Murad also. Finally, Aurangzeb became complete ruler. Shuja not interested in throne, so Aurangzeb left this Shuja. Shuja submitted his kingdom to Aurangzeb, so Aurangzeb did not kill Shuja. Finally, Aurangzeb became a complete ruler. In 1658, Aurangzeb killed Shah Jahan also. In 1658, Aurangzeb killed Shah Jahan. He killed his own father. Aurangzeb did not interested to contribute in art and architecture, whereas Shah Jahan is very much interested in art and architecture. For the construction of Taj Mahal Red Fort, Aurangzeb killed this Shah Jahan. Before that, Aurangzeb imprisoned Shah Jahan in a jail and served him without any food and water. Later, he killed Shah Jahan. According to Aurangzeb, this construction of monuments means misusing the public property. Aurangzeb is very cruel. He is just like Alauddin Khilji. He killed many rulers, and then he used to give harsh punishments to public. Aurangzeb assumed the title Alamgir, that is the old conqueror. He is the old conqueror. That means he used to extend his kingdom very much. He is very powerful ruler. He even imprisoned Shivaji Maharaj also. Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj of Maratha Empire. He imprisoned Shivaji Maharaj and his son also. That much powerful he is. During 1707, Aurangzeb died. He got natural death. No one killed him. And buried at Daulatabad. He ruled from 1658 to 1707. This is what about Mughals. Actually, this is not the end of Mughals. This is the just the end of Great Mughals. After Aurangzeb also, there were Mughal rulers. So many people thought that Aurangzeb is the last ruler of Mughals. But actually, Aurangzeb is not the last ruler. He is the last great ruler. From Babur to Aurangzeb, they were called as Great Mughals. After Aurangzeb, till 1857, this is the first War of Independence. Till then, Mughals ruled. These were known as last Mughals. After Aurangzeb, his son only ruled, continued like hereditary. However, these were puppet rulers, all the power under ministers only. So that only these were called as last Mughals. These were known as great Mughals. Till 1857, Mughals ruled this is what about Mughals. Now we will see some important terms in Mughals. Babur died at 1530 at Agra, and his tomb is in Kabul. Humayun died on 27th Jan 1556, died accidentally. His tomb is in Delhi. Who Humayun? His tomb is a UNESCO site, UNESCO World Heritage Site. Actually, his tomb was constructed by his wife. It is the first garden tomb in Indian subcontinent. His wife Hazi Begum constructed in the memory of her husband Humayun. Next, Navaratnas. Navaratnas, that means nine jewels of Akbar's court. First one is Birbal. Actual name is Mahesh Das. He is the advisor. Second, Abul Fazl. He wrote Ain-e-Akbari, Faizi, mathematician, Todarmal, his Diwan, Bhagwant Das, Sufi mystic, Man Singh, sixth one, Man Singh, Commander in Chief, Tansen, he is a musician, Abdur Rahim, he is the son of Bairam Khan. Mirza Aziz Koka, he is the advisor. Like Birbal, he is also one of the advisor of Akbar. These were the nine Navaratnas in Akbar's court. Now we will see sources of Mughals. During ancient India, we have inscriptions. Nowadays, we all have cell phones, everything na, so that our future generation people will come to know about us. But how do we know about all these things? At that time, we doesn't have cell phones, right? Kings used to write through inscriptions. In ancient India, we have inscriptions like Shasanalu. In Telugu, we call it as Shasanalu. That means pillar inscriptions, Shila Shasanalu, like that. During ancient India, we have inscriptions. In medieval India, there were travelers who used to write about king and then administrations, so that only we come to know all these things. Otherwise, we doesn't know what happened in our past. As of now, we are having cell phones, video cams, technology improved a lot, so that our future generation people will come to know us easily. Now we will see some sources about Mughals. Sources. Ignore my handwriting because I am writing through pen tab. Muntakab ul Lubab. This was wrote by Kafi Khan. Wrote by Kafi Khan. This deals about Aurangzeb. This book deals about Aurangzeb. Next, शनामा रोट बाय अब्दुल हमीद लाहौरी इट डील्स अबाउट शाहजहान इकबाल नामा ई जहांगीरी दिस वॉज रोट बाय मोहम्मद खान इट डील्स अबाउट जहांगीर एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन गुलबदन बेगम शी रोट अबाउट हुमायूं नामा She is the daughter of Humayun. She wrote about Humayun. That book name is known as Humayun Nama. Now Akbar Nama. Or Ain-e Akbari. This is a book on Akbar which wrote by Abul Fazl. These were the sources of Mughals. This is what about Mughals. Thanks for watching this video. If you like this video, hit like button. Thank you.